So consensus algorithms are the new upcoming thing, the hot topic in the area of the blockchain technology. Now, if you talk of consensus, what does it actually mean in Hindi language, which we normally speak? We say ek common rai hona, ek mat rai. Or we say razamandi, jahan sab logo ki ek jaisi rai banke aaye kisi particular mudde ke upar. So consensus algorithms are difficult to create, clearly, because in a democratic setup, if you want that consensus should come, very difficult to achieve actually. In an autocratic setup, it is so easy because the dictator will issue a guidelines, everyone has to follow that. So consensus algorithms is a very important part of the distributed computing concept, which is widely used in blockchain technology as of today. And this is used in order to provide a means of agreeing to a single version of the truth by all the peers on the blockchain network. Now, on a single blockchain network, we may have hundreds and thousands of nodes, and there could be a parallel transactions running on these nodes. Now, somewhere common consensus is required among all the people who are in the part of the blockchain network. It should not happen that one person is saying something else for the transaction, another person is saying something else for the transaction. So all the people have to agree on a common line that these transactions are immutable. What blockchain technology principle says, they cannot be modified, they are perfectly transparent, and they follow the concept of the decentralization. So you got DIT principle of the blockchain technology, decentralization, immutability, and transparency. So everyone has to toe the single line. And we said truth is always in the form of zero or one. You cannot have the concocted truth or a partial truth or a truth in its multiple variants. So either the transaction is running or it is not running. Either transaction is modified or it is not modified. So very popularly, there are two kinds of the consensus algorithm which have come up over a period of time. One is a permissionless and one is a permission type. Now name itself says one, you require a permission, and for the other, you don't require a permission because the name itself are self-explanatory in nature. For one kind of algorithm, you require this, for example, a democratic setup. You require a consensus to come among all the citizens of the country to choose a party. So the party which will win maximum number of votes will be voted to power. That's how the common consensus goes as such. So many people are agreeing on a fact that this candidate of party A is good candidate, should be won. And that's why maximum polling will happen for the particular candidate of a party and he will win. So that means a common consensus have arrived that this candidate is a good candidate or this party is a good party and they should be voted to power. Let's take the first one, permissionless consensus type. We say it's commonly proof-based, a leader election lottery-based system. Now, whereby a leader is elected at random, so no voting is taking place, no consensus is arriving, a leader has been chosen. At random, any leader can be chosen, any particular person of a party will be chosen. So it's work more on the PRN election algorithm. PRN is a pseudo-random number. Randomly, you pick up somebody and propose a final value. For example, if you take a real-time example, there are two ways. If I want to select a CR for a class, one is all the students should vote for him. Other is the dean sir says, or the head of the department says, he is a good student. And he is good in academics, he is good in extracurricular activities, he takes good initiative in a class, he is punctual. So they will vote him the CR of a class representative, because he possesses all the good qualities of a leader as such. So here what we are doing, we are going for a nomination by a HOD, because he has seen a candidate who has certain good merits and he votes him to power, he gives him the rights that you are the right person to have the class monitor, or more like a class representative. In a class monitor word we use in a school level, in a university system we say a union leader or a class CR. So those of you who have come from the Delhi University colleges, you would have seen the elections, the DUSU elections taking place there. So there the people, the students vote for a particular candidate from ABVP or from the NSUI, and then they won the election and they come to the power. But then not everywhere we require the voting to take place. In a democratic setup, yes, voting will take place. But in a permissionless system, no voting is taking place. It's a nomination work. A person is nominated on certain merits by the head of the department or by the seat of power. So this category is also referred to as a fully decentralized or permissionless type of the consensus mechanism, where no consensus will be generated and randomly any person who found fit for a role will be voted to power. He will be given the charge to manage the blockchain network. And this type of the consensus mechanism widely used in the Bitcoin and the Ethereum blockchain in the form of the POW, that is proof of work mechanism. So we'll discuss two kind of the mechanism, proof of work and proof of stake. We say the POW and POS. So when we talk of the permissionless consensus type blockchain mechanism, it's widely used in the form of the POW mechanism, a proof of work mechanism, which we'll discuss in subsequent slides. What is POW? Now, second kind of mechanism is a consensus type, where it's more like a democratic setup, where election of a CR will be done in a democratic manner. Just like what I, the example I took in Delhi University colleges, the voting gets done. The student vote for a particular candidate from president, vice president, secretary, treasurer. You know, the candidate could be from ABBP or NSUI or any other SFI, any other student part politics. And then the particular candidate will be won and he will come to power and then he will fight for the student issues. So here it's more like a permission. You give a permission of the all the miners who are managing the transaction of a blockchain network. Their permission will be taken into account and then any transaction will be finalized, that this is going to be persisted in a blockchain network. So this class of consensus is also known as consortium or permission type of the consensus mechanism. But consensus mechanism perform well when there are limited number of nodes, and they may not perform well when the scale, when the issue of scaling come. For example, you would have seen the announcement of the election in 5 states by the Election Commission of India. So in smaller state, it's easy to go for an election in one phase. So all the citizens of that particular state will vote for our candidates in one day across the state. But in a bigger state like the UP, they have done in the phasing manner, because the entire state is almost as good as country. So if you look in the listing of the country population wise, UP is almost as good as any sixth country in the world in terms of population density, in terms of size, in terms of economic power, everything if you take into account. So if the scale, if they do not scale well, means if the number of nodes or the number of the citizens or the population size is very high, the number of constituencies is very high in the states, then it's very difficult to achieve a single level, single day voting, because so many deployment of the officers have to be done in voting. So many, or not only officers, but the paramilitary forces, the police have to be deployed. So it's very difficult to achieve all the level of voting on a single day in a big state. So they look good when the scale is low, when the number of citizens are less, population density is low, state size is less, you can have a single day voting. But when it grows up, it's difficult to achieve. Same way, if you got a blockchain network, the few number of the nodes running a transaction in parallel, permission is good, consensus is easy to achieve. But if you have a global blockchain network with thousands of stock exchanges involved into it, millions of the transaction happening parallelly across the world, then to achieve a consensus is very, very difficult job. Now we have got two popular concepts under the consensus algorithms. We say proof of work and the proof of stake. So proof of stake was first created in 2012 by two developers called Scott Nadell and the Sunny King. They were the initial two people who came up with the concept for the very first time. So proof of work reward its miner for solving complex equations. So proof of work, you will a particular miner or the particular person who is entering a transaction into a node of a blockchain network will be rewarded if he does something good, if he does something great, like solving complex mathematical equations. That's one of the example. Otherwise, any kind of the financial transaction happening, and if he is able to commit it and enter into a network, he will be rewarded for the work he has done. In proof of stake, the individual that creates the next block is based on how much they have staked, how many number of blocks a person is able to create and add in the blockchain network. And every block we know will involve the concept of hashing. So how many number of a hashing algorithm you are using, and does every block of a blockchain have a different hashing algorithm, or they're using the same algorithm for all the blocks of a blockchain network. So what is at the stake? So more the number of hashing technique, more the amount content of the security. In the context of security, more the number of hashing technique, better it is. If you're using a single hashing algorithm for all the blocks in a blockchain network, so chances of security breach are very, very high. But if you use a randomly any hashing technique, or you use a more like a hashing bank is there, a bank having multiple number of hashing techniques or hashing algorithms, it brings more security into the blockchain network. So stake is basically the number of the coins the person has for a particular blockchain that they're attempting to mine. So we need to monetize the stake. What is at the stake? How many number of the coins? Now everything is virtual currency here. It's all, as we have discussed earlier, also cryptocurrency in Ethereum. It's all virtual currency. So for every transaction, you will have to have how many number of the coins you are going to put on that particular transaction. For example, and when we were discussing the smart contracts, we discussed the gas. Gas is again the unit for determining the quantum of efforts required to create a transaction, mine a transaction, and store the transaction in a blockchain network. So this slide should give you a major differences regarding both of them, proof of work and proof of stake. The proof of work was first conceptualized in 1999, so quite a long time back, by two persons by the name Jacobson and Jules, and they published a document which is available as a white paper on the web, wherein they introduced the concept of the very first time, proof of the work, that you have done some work, now you must have a documentary proof of the same thing that you have successfully done. So proof of work is a requirement to define an expensive computer calculation. Now, expensive computer calculation means any kind of calculation that requires a lot of resources, a system-based resources, like your CPU cycles, or the number of files which you are opening for reading or writing, the number of database connections you are creating, the number of network connections you have got. So they all define expensive computer calculation that needs to be performed in order to create a new group of the trustless transaction on a distributed ledger called as a blockchain. Now, all the transactions here, by default, they are assumed that they will be trusted. So transactions are popularly called a trustless, means they don't require the extra trust factor to be imposed. All the transactions which are going to be executed by default will have a trust factor attached to it. Because again, we've got three basic principles of blockchain: decentralization, immutability, and transparency. So transactions are all transparent. They're all clearly visible to all the miners who are creating a block in a blockchain, who are calculating the transactions and archiving them in the nodes of the blockchain. So everything is visible to it. And all the people who are successfully able to do it, we reward them with the proper crypto. So miners are the person who are able to create a block in a blockchain network, who introduce a new kind of hashing technique to solve and to save the complex data in the blockchain network. And once they have successfully done it, they are awarded with suitable amount of the cryptocurrency for the amount of the work they have done. Parallelly, we have got another consensus mechanism called proof of stake, which was first created in 2012 by the Scott Nadal and Sunny King. They were the first people who came up with this concept for the very first time, that we should have also something called as a concept called proof of stake. Now, in proof of stake, we will have the miners, but in the person who are called miners in proof of work, they will now be called as a validators. So when we talk about the proof of work, we use the word miners, and when we use the concept called proof of stake, we refer to a person as validator. And what will the validator do? They will lock up some of their cryptocurrencies as a stake in the ecosystem. So once the global blockchain network for any financial transaction gets starting created, these validators will lock up some of their cryptocurrencies as a stake in the ecosystem. Following that, the validators bet on certain blocks. So there could be 100 and 1000 and lakhs of a block in a blockchain network, and they will bet on certain block that they feel will be added to the next chain. So it's more like randomly also they can do it, or they can apply certain probability for seeing that what will be the next block which can get added to the blockchain network. And when the blocks get added, the validators get a block reward in proportion to their stake. So initially they will have a coin, they will put a bet on certain block which can get added to the blockchain network, And if this happens, then yes, they will be rewarded for the amount of the stake the they have put onto the particular node. So it's more like a betting phenomena. For example, more like a bid and buy. You would have seen just like the Cars 24 example. If you go to sell a car to Cars 24, they will put your car on the bidding and they will set certain base value. And then the all over India, all of the centers are already connected on the web. They will say that there's a car called Maruti Wagon R, which was manufactured in 2019. And depending on the model, the condition of it, it will be put onto the bidding platform. And then the people around the all over India where Cars 24 has the centers, they will start bidding onto it. And moment they get the higher bid, they will sell off that particular car. So it's more like a same concept here. You start bidding on the particular block, and if your block get added to the blockchain network, you will be immediately rewarded for the work you have done or for the transaction which has been created and mined into the blockchain network. So both the validators get awarded in the proof of stake, and the miners get rewarded into the proof of work. Now this slide is also a very important slide found on the web, which I thought of sharing it up. If you look at the proof of work, originally dates back to the first 1993, but the first original paper came to be concepted in 1999. But the concept dates back to almost 30 years back. It came in 2012, the proof of stake. It requires advanced computation, but advanced computation power is only required when you have a large number of transactions to be recorded into the blockchain network. If the number of transactions are less, then you don't require advanced computation power. Here, proof of work power computation is very massive. It's very less in the case of the proof of stake. We need to solve a mathematical algorithm to win a battle here. For example, if you are handling multiple number of transactions and you are trying to develop a mathematical algorithm, you need to solve it to win a battle. Here, the stakes are limited. So need to stake highest to win the battle. A stake can be in the form of the cryptocurrency. Now, cryptocurrency is something that may not applicable in the proof of work earlier, but after Vitalik Buterin introduced the Ethereum, the cryptocurrency becomes the reward in both of them, in proof of work also, in proof of stake also. Here it is given to the miners, here it is given to the validators. So to solve the complex puzzle, it required time for which the Bitcoin adds block within the 10 minutes. So it's just an example which has been taken that if you have been given a task to do it, now what is the minimum amount of task you were being required to do the task and add it to the blockchain network. So time here is taken as a 10 minutes base. In proof of stake, you don't need to solve the puzzle, so it takes less time to validate. So here we do not may require computation is not that very high in proof of stake as compared to the proof of work. Block reward is there in both of them. Block reward is there, which is rewarded to a miner after successful completion of adding a block. Initially it was not there, but nowadays with the evolution of more cryptocurrencies, no block award is nothing, but now the block award is being given and to the validators in the form of the cryptocurrencies. Because if you don't give the reward, people won't work, or the transaction, new transaction will not get added to the blockchain network. And almost all the major blockchain platform like use the proof of work algorithms like Bitcoin and the Ether. And here the popular technique which are being used is the Dash and the EOS. So proof of work, if you have 51% of the network capacity, then you can add a malicious block which can achieve if you can bring some highly advanced technology into the blockchain. Now, malicious block is something which is non-secure block. So if you have 51% network capacity, it may happen that the hackers might introduce certain block which may not be perfectly secure block, what's called as a malicious block. So here the miners who are being rewarded have to be very careful regarding the security of the block, that your hashing technique should not be spoofed. Nobody should be able to know about the different kind of the rounds and the permutation combination blocks which are being used in the hashing algorithm. But in the point of stake, one must be 51% share of the total share is spread in the market, which seems impossible to protect the network. So it's something like who will control the market? Who will control the stake into the network as such? So just like if you start a company or maybe a startup as such, how much amount of equity you are having and how much amount of equity you want to give to the venture capitalist or the other stakeholders. So if you give more than 51%, then they are going to control the company and you are going to be just obeying their orders. but if you want to be in the driving force, you should not allow anyone to have the stake more than 49%. Otherwise, they will control the market, and then they will control the company, and they will ask you what to do and what not to do. So 51% stake is considered the common stake in the global blockchain network also. A person should not be allowed to have more than 49-51 ratio. It's something like this. 51 should be the maximum and not beyond that. Now, once the transaction has been recorded into the nodes of a blockchain, we need to create a tree-like manner. And now in the blockchain technology, we have a tree called Merkle tree. It was first named after the Ralph Merkle, who patented the idea of the tree formation way back in 1979. So the tree was already there quite a long time back. Then blockchain technology started using it in the organization of a block, in the creation of the block in a tree-like manner. So we'll have a root of the tree. We'll have a intermediate nodes, the level 1, level 2 nodes, and then we'll have the leaf nodes. Just like any tree is there, same way we'll have a tree here in the Merkle. The name is given just after its founder, called as a Merkle tree. The name of the person was Ralph Merkle, who introduced the concept for the first time in 79. So Merkle tree is any binary tree in which the inputs are first placed at the leaf. That is node where they have no children. And then the value of the pair of the child nodes are hashed together. So we can use any hashing technique like MD5 algorithm or SHA algorithm, or maybe design our own hashing technique that will depend upon the company who is creating a Merkle tree to produce a value for the parent node, that is for the internal node. Now that is also non-leaf node or the intermediate node or the internal node. Until a single hash value known as a Merkle root is achieved. So we'll start formation of the tree from the leaf node going up till the root node. That's how the typical functionality or the flow of the information will take place in a Merkle tree. Now, what are the proper advantages of Merkle tree? Why it's being used? It's a tree that helps you provide and maintain the integrity and the validity of the data. So we know in our blockchain network, we'll have multiple number of the chain of nodes. Every node will have certain amount of data, depend upon the what kind of data you want to store, then the timestamp, then the hash of the previous node, and then the hash of the current node. Now somewhere it may happen that certain attacks might take place on the blocks of the blockchain network. So we require certain tree-like formations, some of which one of them is a Merkle tree, which helps to maintain both the integrity of the data as well as the validity of the data, whether it's correct or not. Merkle tree also helps to Merkle tree enables secure and efficient verification of the large data sets. It helps in saving a lot of buffer space because the formation takes place in a tree-like manner. And it also requires tiny amount of information to be transmitted across the network, thus saving a network bandwidth. So you don't have to transmit large amount of the packets, the large quantum of packets running into the kilobytes to terabytes across the network. So to this tree, if you create this tree with the nodes, and these nodes will have a hash value, and the amount of data to be transmitted on the network will be considerably less if you go for a linked list creation or any other kind of the data structure you use. But if you get a Merkle tree, it will help you to save a lot of bandwidth, which has been found experimentally. Now let's take an example to create a Merkle tree like situation. We got a credit card number, which is 25 digit long. So we could take any sample credit card number. The first in the yellow bar indicates 16 digit credit card number. The next green color indicates 3 digit CVV number. And the last 6 digit indicate the expiry date of the card. Let's say April 2026. So 16 plus 3 is 19, 19 plus 6 is 25. 25 digit for the credit card. Suppose this is what we want to secure. And for this credit card number, I want to create a Merkle tree. So what should be my approach? How to go for it? First, I start splitting my data into form of small blocks. So what we do here, we create 5 blocks. Each block having 5 digit of the data. So 21234 becomes the first block, 15623 becomes a second block, 78123 becomes a third block, 44350 become a fifth block, 042026 become a fifth block. So first, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So you got five blocks, each block having 5 digits of the data, and then overall 5 into 5, 25 digits have now been handled. Now what do we do next? We create a table in which on the very first column, if you see here, are the serial number. Data 1 block, data 2, data 3, data 4, and the data 5. Now what is the data 1 block here? The first block here, 21234. The block having the first 5 digits of the credit card. Then the second data block contains the next 5 digits of the credit card, 15623. Then third data block contains the next 5 digits of the credit card, 78123. Then D4 contains the fourth block of the digits, 44350. And the fifth contains the last block of the digit, 42026. So we've got 5 data blocks now, and then we calculate the hash value for it. Now, how do we compute the hash value? We use the MD5 algorithm, because there are two very popular algorithms, as we have discussed earlier also when we did the Java program, MD5 and the SHA. They are the most popular algorithm which we use for the computation of the credit card numbers. So just let me share. What do we do here is we use the data block and then we make a call to the MD5 algorithm with the set values 21234. So what do we do here? We invoke the MD5 algorithm. There are many number of the MD5 calculators available on the web. So we invoke one of the very popular MD5 hash calculator and we put the value 21234. I hope it is visible. Is it visible? Anyone can say yes or no?
Visible, sir.
Fine. So what do we do? Because one option is that we write our own program to do it. But our objective right now is to create a Merkle tree and not to calculate the hash value. So it's better that we use any predefined hash calculator and calculate the MD5 hash value for it. And it gives us the value comprising hexadecimal digits 01044CFD. So what do we do here? We put the same hash value 01044CFD, which have been taken directly from the hash calculator. And then we can same way calculate the MD5 hash value for all the data blocks. So our next data block is 15623, right? So again, we go back to the hash calculator and then we enter the value 15623 here. And it again calculates the hash value for it and comes to be 84FC285. So we go to the here, 84FC285 and so on. Same way, we calculate the hash value for the third data block. We calculate the hash value for fourth data block. We calculate the hash value for the fifth data block. So here right now we are only dealing with one credit card number. But if you take any bank, for example, the SBI or the HDFC or ICICI, they have issued so many number of the credit and debit card numbers to their customers, running into thousands and lakhs. So if they want to store all this information in a form of a blockchain network exclusively for SBI, or a blockchain network designed exclusively for the HDFC bank, or the blockchain network exclusively designed for the ICICI bank, that itself will have a many, many millions of nodes. 1 million is equal to 10 lakh. So more than 10 lakh customers would be there who would be using the credit card for the SBI or the HDFC or ICICI. So millions of customers are already there for these banks. So if they want to store the data of these customers who are having a credit card number, because the credit card will have a credit card number, the CVE number, credit card verification value number, which is this in a green color, and the purple color, the expiry date. So if they're having 10 lakh customer, so they will have at least 10 lakh nodes in a global blockchain network, one node dedicated to one customer. Or what they can do, they can start doing the grouping. Let's say they say for the entire Delhi, we'll have one blockchain network. Means they are going for decentralization. So one SBI blockchain network exclusively for all the customers who are having SBI credit card only from the Delhi. Then they will have another blockchain network exclusively for all the credit card holders of the SBI for the West Bengal or for the Tamil Nadu or for the Central India. So they can go for decentralization. That becomes easy managing in the because global blockchain network to manage is very, very difficult. But local blockchain network to manage is comparatively easy. I don't say very, very easy, but it's comparatively very easy as compared to it. So one node will store the information about the one credit card number. So I need to use the hash values. So we use the MD5 algorithms, which will generate the hash values for every data block of the credit card. Now, once it has been generated, what do I do next? I go for the creation of the tree, and as the literature of the Merkle tree just let us know that we need to start from the bottom. So we will have the data blocks right at the bottom. So D1, D2, D3, D4, and the D5. So every data block here is representing the D1, D2, D3, D4, and D5 here. So what is a D1? It is a hash content of what? 21234, which is the first 5 digits of the credit card. What is a D2? It is a hash value of what? The data block 15623. Where? What is 15623? The next 5 digit of the credit card. What is a D3? It is containing the hash value of what? The 78123. What is 78123? Third set of the 5 digits of the given credit card number. So that is how we are referring to D1, D2, D3, D4 in our Merkle tree. Now moving up, because the tree formation starts from the leaf node, going up to the Merkle root. So we'll have the block which will contain the hash values. So let's say these are the hash values. Now we'll have the level 2 block 0. Level 2, let's move up. So now we'll have the these two become the child node of the parent node. So hash 2 here for L1. L1, what is the level 1? So we start creating a parent node of the given two child node, and these themselves are carrying the hash values. So 3, the level is 0, and again the level 1. So this is like a parent node for these two child node. This becomes a parent node for these two child nodes, and this is a fifth block. So there are no it's not in binary, so we don't require a neighboring block to be added to it. So it is going all standalone here. Now we'll again move further. We go to the hash 0, which is formed or created by the bringing together or generating a hash value of the block 2 and the block 3. So now if you look here, let's go right up the top. Let's go to the Merkle root. Yeah, the top hash value. Now what did the top hash value contain? It's a hash 0 plus hash 1. So this is hash block 0 and the hash block 1. Now if you look at the hash 0, this is the parent block for this hash 2 and hash 3 block. This hash 1 is the parent block for this hash 10 block. Now if you look at the 2 here, 2 is a parent node, 0 is a level number. 2 refers to the parent node, 1 is a ID for this particular node. 3 is a block number because 0, 1, 2 and the 3. So 3 refers to the parent ID. 0 is the individual ID of this block, 3-0. This 3 refers again to the parent hash node, and 1 is an individual ID for it. So we start creating the tree from the bottom till we reach to the Merkle root, and every block here is containing the hash data, because the entire tree is a hash tree. If you look at every block, it is just nothing but a hash values of the data it is receiving from the child node, from the leaf node. So from the D1 and D2, they are the hash value which are being input here. Then 2-0 and 2-1 are the two child block, the intermediate block or the internal nodes of the Merkle tree. And then this is a parent node of these two child blocks, which are nothing but a hash values. So we'll have generate a next set of hash values which will be formed by the merging or the addition or the concatenation of these two child nodes. So again, we'll have 30 hash 31. This block will do a hashing of both these blocks, and then we'll get a content of the hash 3 block. Same way, one hash 1, hash 2 and hash 3 blocks are ready, then we generate the hash 0 block. So which will again be formed by the combination of the creation of both hash 2 and hash 3 block. From the D5, it's a only standalone block. We directly go up as it is. then hash 0 and the hash 1, and both of them will be hashed to get a top Merkle root top hash value 00. So that's how typical formation of the Merkle tree take place, starting from the leaf node going up to the top node, that is called as a Merkle root. So this is what the concept was first introduced by Ralph Merkle, and blockchain technology have started using it because this tree also uses the hash value, and in the blockchain also we arrange all the chain of block in a sequential format. So instead of arranging in a sequential format, here we arrange in a tree like manner, because in sequential it can go very long, the list can be very very long as such, and searching might take a lot of time. But when you go for a Merkle tree formation, the searching becomes efficient and the arrangement of the nodes is also easy to understand as compared to the way the blockchains are being created in a sequential manner. But otherwise, internally, if you see, the concept are same. Then the blockchain network also, each and every node will have a set of hash values. Here also we'll have a set of hash values. But the only point of difference is that if you arrange all the block in a chain of blocks, the first block we say always is a genesis block, which will not have a predecessor of any previous block. It's a first block. Here we don't have something called the genesis block in the case of the Merkle tree, because here we do not contain the predecessors of the previous block, just like what the sequential blockchain contains. Here it's more like a tree-like formation, starting from the leaf node going up to the top-level Merkle root. So here the traversing is simple, the searching is faster and efficient as compared to the sequential chain of blocks. So we